If people would take their seats, please. We're about to get started. Thank you. Welcome. Good afternoon, and welcome to Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School. Today marks a milestone for our community, the dedication and celebration of the first new school in the City of Falls Church in more than half a century. We are delighted all of you could join us today, and we are especially honored to have with us Mary Ellen Henderson's son, Dr. James H.M. Henderson, and many other members of the Henderson family. Will you please stand and be recognized? Family. We are also honored to have with us today Dr. Joe Lindemary, Virginia Superintendent for Instruction, U.S. Representative Jim Moran, State Senator Mary Margaret Whipple, Delegate Jim Scott, and Mayor Dan Gardner. Thank you all for sharing in our special day. Let us begin our celebration with the Pledge of Allegiance. Please rise as the American Legion Color Guard from Post 130 in Falls Church presents the colors. Middle school representatives Julia Estrada, Max Kaplow, and Gemma Sedita will lead us in saying the pledge. To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you, students, and thank you, members of the American Legion Color Guard. One thing I'd like to point out is that two members of the Guard, Commander John Johnson and historian Mike Strickler, actually attended our schools at one time, so this occasion has a personal meaning for them as well. Reaching this point has been quite a journey. So many people played a part in making this new school happen that we'd take a week to mention everybody who was involved. However, the common themes we saw through this process were community, teamwork, and partnership. First and foremost, we must express our enormous gratitude to this community for supporting the bond referendum that made this school possible. On behalf of the students we serve, thank you, citizens, for making public education a priority in Falls Church. Special thanks go to a grassroots organization, Falls Church Cares. Members of that organization helped educate our voters about the importance of the new school. Without their work, we may not have been here today. People who gave their time to Falls Church Cares, would you please stand and be recognized? I'd also like to thank the faculty, staff, and community members who helped make this transition year go smoothly for our students by putting in countless hours serving on committees over the past years. There was the Curriculum Realignment Committee, the Start Times Committee, the Green Schools Committee, the Architect Selection and Advisory Committee, the School Naming Committee, the Calendar Committee, and the Dedication Ceremony Committee. Members of these committees, please stand and be recognized. Our City Council and School Board made a great team, working closely together on everything from strategic planning to site selection to financing. Members of the City Council and School Board, please stand and be recognized. We found another great team in the two superintendents who saw the process through from start to finish. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mary Ellen Shaw and Lois Berlin.
I'm very grateful to Lois and the school board for including me in this grand celebration of the completion of a project that had its roots in the previous decade and was preceded by many things: studies of facilities, school size and grade configuration options, demographic trends and enrollment projections, and an exhaustive search for land in which to build a new school. As a survivor of many school renovation and construction projects, I am very pleased that this experience was a true joy thanks to these factors: a well-negotiated contract with a guaranteed maximum price and a provision for shared savings, expert construction management services from CDG, from concept development through construction and on into punch list completion, an outstanding construction team from Clark and Berry Rio with wonderful problem-solving skills and a real can-do attitude that overcame obstacles and kept this project on track to this successful completion we experience today. For me professionally, finishing up a year that has been very satisfying personally in retirement, I can best summarize my feelings by quoting from the last stanza in an old classic that I heard as I drove over here today. Somewhere, and I'd sing it, but you'd really be sorry. I've learned some new things in retirement. I haven't learned how to sing on a professional basis. Somewhere over the rainbow, skies are blue, and the dreams that you dare to dream really do come true. Thank you.
When I arrived in Falls Church July of last year, there was a big hole in the ground where we are celebrating today. And during the summer and into the fall, I watched the steel rise out of that hole and the building come under cover. While it was thrilling and sometimes nerve-wracking, everything went remarkably smoothly, and I really have to thank Mary Ellen Shaw and the school board for that. They did a remarkable job of planning this project, and they communicated that plan very clearly, making it easy for me to get up to speed and see the project through to completion. I am also grateful to the administration, faculty, staff, parents, and community members who gave countless hours of their time and attention to the various committees that considered everything from the school's name to appropriate curriculum to start times to building materials. I'm grateful to the wonderful teams from CDG, Clark, and Berry Rio who made the mysteries of construction transparent and worked so well with the school system and with each other to make this building a reality. The dedication of all these groups helped ensure a smooth start to this school year, and I have to say the first day couldn't have been gone more smoothly, and it was so wonderful to see children walking the halls of this building and see the purpose of all the work. So on behalf of our students, thank you all for your support. It's truly a happy day. Thank you.
When the school board set out to select a name for the new school, part of the criteria was that the school be named for distinguished persons who have made outstanding historical contributions to the state or nation, consistent with the magnitude of the contributions made by persons whose names are already used for schools in the division. Mary Ellen Henderson may not have been known on the world stage, but her work here in Falls Church was part of a broad movement that changed this community and this country for the better. She is a shining example of how one person can make a profound difference in so many lives. As you'll see from this video presentation, she didn't exactly plan it that way, but life is a journey that sometimes takes some unexpected turns.
You can still see the old home place on South Maple Street in Falls Church on what used to be the Henderson family farm.
Oh, it's still there, built in 1913.
It was where Dr. E.B. Henderson and his wife Mary Ellen Henderson planned to raise their children and live a good life. They were both educators, although Mary Ellen left the profession when they married in 1910, and she assumed her life's role would be wife, mother, and homemaker.
And when I came out here, I had no idea of ever teaching again.
But a few years later, World War I started, and many teachers left the profession to join the war effort. As a result, there was a shortage of teachers on the home front. That's when community leaders turned to Mary Ellen Henderson for help.
And in fact, when they came to me to open Falls Church School after it was closed, why, because of no teacher, I refused. I had a baby, 14 months old.
But when community leaders found someone to watch her baby, Mary Ellen Henderson agreed to return to teaching and open the old two-room, wood-frame, colored schoolhouse on Annandale Road. Little did she know it was only the beginning of a remarkable lifelong journey as a teacher, a civil rights activist, and a community volunteer.
I can remember every morning she'd take that little black bag of hers and walk 2 miles down to the school. Every morning, rain or shine, she was on her way with that little black bag. My mother had fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh grades. And I always remember there were four, there was a stove in the middle of the room.
Like she had class number, the seventh grade up front, maybe reading. She was, the other class members were in the back in their seats doing their homework. So when she was ready for them to come up, then they would be ready. No noise or anything.
She was an excellent teacher. Believe in discipline. And when she told you don't do this or don't do that, you didn't do it.
That was something Mary White admits she learned the hard way the day she drew a picture on the blackboard. She thought Mary Ellen Henderson, known as Miss Nellie to her students, wasn't looking.
I wrote over top of it, old gray-haired Nellie. Then I tried to erase it. Miss Nellie goes back to the board, draws the same picture on the board that I drew, wrote the same words up there, and then say it to me, little girl, and whenever she called you little girl, you knew you were in trouble. You go home.
Gene Hudson remembers the day he crossed the line too.
And like the boy sat next to me with Earl Sutton, him and I be playing. And she wouldn't even look up. She said, Hudson? Or she said, Sutton? No, we're not doing that. She said, Hudson? Right today, I still don't know how she could see us.
Mary Ellen Henderson modeled high standards of excellence and expected nothing less from her students.
I knew, you know, that we were segregated and we, of course, did not have the things that the other schools had. But I would like to think that it was sufficient at that time because we did learn and it was a good start.
Her pupils were so well prepared in the three R's that when they went to the Francis Junior High School in Washington, she was complimented for having prepared them so well for the upper grades.
That was high praise indeed, especially when you consider the condition of the school from which they came. The dilapidated structure was heated by a wood-burning stove in the middle of the room that Mary Ellen Henderson or one of her students managed.
We used to volunteer to go down early in the morning and make the fire with a big old wood stove in there. And I was one of them and come along and made the wood fire and got the classroom started. Make sure we had to go out, had a well aside, take a bucket and go get the water and have fresh and have a dip with that we drank out of.
There wasn't any running water there at all, obviously. And I'm not going to begin to tell you about the outhouses, but both teachers and students, you know, outside, one for the male, one for the female. Oh, it's terrible.
By contrast, schools for white children had all the modern conveniences of the day, as well as custodial and maintenance staff. Mary Ellen Henderson studied the vast disparity in resources between Fairfax County's segregated schools, and she used her report to help persuade local leaders to build a new school for black children. The Brick James Lee School opened in 1947, complete with modern amenities and proper staffing. Mary Ellen Henderson served as its first principal until she retired in 1950. Today, the building is home to the James Lee Community Center. In 1969, as part of the 100th anniversary of the Fairfax County Schools, Mary Ellen Henderson was interviewed about her life's work and her legacy to future generations.
I'm glad I lived long enough to see the children getting the fine an education as we had hoped for when we first started out, and things looked so dark.
Today, a new middle school bearing her name stands as a testament to her pursuit of quality public education for all children, her community service, and her devotion to her students and family.
I guess I miss her sweet attitude, her kindness, and always her advice, you know, always very wise advice about living and how to do things in the right way.
She was an excellent teacher. We loved her. We loved Miss Nellie.
Mary Ellen Henderson encouraged her students to pursue educational interests that would lead to a career. She also encouraged them to help others and to give back to the community, behavior she modeled as an active member of the NAACP, the Girl Scouts, the League of Women Voters, and her church. Several of her former students are with us today. Will you please stand and be recognized? Today, Mary Ellen Henderson's legacy and the celebration of our new school are being recognized throughout the Commonwealth. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Virginia Superintendent for Instruction, Dr. Jo Lynn DeMary.
Thank you so much for allowing me to be part of this wonderful celebration. I think that you've sent a wonderful message to your young people that there's important work that goes on in schools and that it deserves a facility worthy of that task. And also, you have certainly had the leadership and the vision to know that the future of your community also comes to this school and that you want to make sure that you do the best job possible. I have the honor of not only bringing you greetings on behalf of the Virginia Department of Education today, but the Governor of Virginia. And I'd like to present Mrs. Chandler with the Certificate of Recognition. By virtue of the authority vested by the Constitution of the Governor of the Commonwealth of Virginia, there is hereby officially recognized Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School Day. Whereas women of every race, class, and ethnic background have made historic contributions to the growth and strength of our Commonwealth in countless recorded and unrecorded ways. And whereas Mary Ellen Henderson, a well-educated African-American teacher, successfully educated black children in a wood frame school on Annandale Road at a time when Virginia schools were segregated and there was a great disparity in resources between schools for white children and schools for black children. And whereas Mrs. Henderson studied the vast disparity in resources between white and black schools and used her findings to help improve the learning environment of her students. And whereas Mrs. Henderson was actively involved in the Falls Church chapter of the NAACP, the local civil rights movement, the League of Women Voters, the Girl Scouts of America, and her church. And whereas the Falls Church School Board selected the anniversary of this extraordinary citizen's birth to dedicate its new middle school in her name and in recognition of her selfless efforts to improve the quality of life for all citizens. Now, therefore, I, Mark R. Warner, do hereby recognize September 18, 2005, as Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School Day in the Commonwealth of Virginia, and I call this observance to the attention of all our citizens. Signed by Mark Warner, Governor of Virginia. Thank you so much.
This is wonderful. I'm sure we'll hang it someplace in the school. It was an act of the Virginia General Assembly that enabled our city to form a partnership with a private contractor to build the school, rather than go through a time-consuming bid process. The public-private partnership enabled us to build the school in record time and helped ensure the school would not exceed a guaranteed maximum price. Anyone who visited the school during the construction phase saw the great care that each worker put into building this building, and their work certainly speaks for itself, doesn't it? Applaud the workers.
Many roads were followed before we finally got on the path to a new middle school, but it's been a real pleasure to see it now coming to completion.
The greatest challenge actually was right at the very beginning when we started the excavation.
The site is actually sitting on an undocumented fill site from like the 1950s, and we had a lot of bad soil, a lot of stumps, and pulled out a car. Bundle of newspapers from the Washington Post from 1957.
The soil that was left over wasn't suitable to support the structure of the building. What we put in were geopiers. We ended up putting them under the entire building.
This is a building that's truly built to support instruction, and I think that's so exciting.
What we've done in the architecture is set up a scenario where the building layout provides for small learning communities. And we've tried to make sure that we could do that so that we could have an identity to each of these areas. Helps kids feel that, you know, that's where they belong.
Our PTA has been terrific, and we've had a lot of parental support and involvement, from planning the 5-7 program to building planning to thinking of coordinating moves. Been great. Fabulous.
We've gone through the naming and the times and everything, and every step of the way it's been a process, but people have pulled together and they've worked it out.
And this is what Falls Church does the best. We work so hard when we work together, and we really, really bring about the prize.
Again, another round of applause for the people who built this building. Several members of the Public-Private Alliance were instrumental in working with our school superintendents to see this project through, and I'd like to recognize them and their companies. Please stand as I call your name. From Barry Rio, architects Bill Brown, Jack Scott, Leslie Slugger, and project manager Rob Shaw. Okay. From Clark, developer Jamie Martin, project executive Keith Couch, project superintendent Dave Seal, and project manager Chris Reed. From Urban Engineers, project engineer Bob Brown. From the Venable Law Firm, Dave Lasso. One of the things we were smart to recognize was that we needed help in doing this. Serving as our representative from the very first draft to the first contract, the last item on the punch list, are the fine folks at Construction Dynamics Group, or CDG. Please stand as we recognize Program Manager Warren Walker and Construction Manager Bob Jones. When the public-private alliance was hard at work building the new building, Dr. Rochelle Friedman was pulling double duty, serving as principal at the old George Mason Middle School and orchestrating everything from furniture orders to staffing for this new school. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School's first principal, Dr. Rochelle Friedman.
Thank you, Mrs. Chandler, ladies and gentlemen, our students. On behalf of the faculty, staff, and students here at Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School, welcome to our school. In my back-to-school letter this year, I told the faculty I hadn't been this excited about the first day of school since my first day at kindergarten. For months, we watched eagerly and sometimes impatiently as our new school was being built. We participated in professional development programs. We talked about opportunities and challenges. We packed, we unpacked, and we prepared to make opening day special for every student. Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School was designed to support instruction and the developmental needs of students grades 5 through 7. As you tour our building today, you'll see separate grade level areas. You'll see areas that support career tech ed programs that offer unlimited possibilities, an inviting library, visual and performance arts classrooms that allow every child to shine, and physical education facilities that truly encourage lifelong learning. You'll see a beautiful facility, but please, try and imagine the classrooms and labs filled with inquisitive young adolescents, questioning, learning, and experiencing that aha moment in education as a new concept becomes clear. Yes, today is a very special day for everyone in the community, but for those of us who are privileged to work and learn here at Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School, there's a special sense of excitement every day. In this wonderful facility, every day, an outstanding, dedicated faculty is committed to providing each and every student the opportunity to explore, to discover, to understand, and to blossom into a lifelong learner, always ready to accept a new challenge. Thank you for our new school, and thank you for being here to share this day with us.
Thank you, Dr. Friedman. If you'd stand right here. I'd like to ask you to stay because some of our special guests come bearing gifts for you. First, our Mayor, Dan Gardner, to share his good wishes on behalf of the Falls Church City Council.
Thank you, Mrs. Chandler. It's an honor to be here today. I'd like everybody to sort of repeat after me a couple of words here. Outstanding. Amazing.
Amazing.
Wonderful.
Wonderful.
Tremendous.
Tremendous.
Success.
Success.
Boy, this is teamwork at its best. Our school boards, I say, because this is a number of people besides the existing school board, are in the school staff, the city councils, and there have been several iterations, the city staff, The PTAs, lots of change there as well. Our students, our teachers, everybody in this community. This is a success for the community, the City of Falls Church. And it's all about giving our children a first-class education. And it proves, this is a symbol of the faith and the trust and the importance that this community places on our young children's education. We have some of our senior citizens here today, Jesse Thackeray, Lou Olam, and others, who built the foundation, the community spirit that made this school successful, that rising up from that hole in the ground. And it's just a pleasure to be here today. It's important that we continue this effort. It's important that we continue to remember we have to build our economic base in the City of Falls Church. We've got our city center redevelopment coming up, and that's going to make this school continue to be successful, and that's the engine that we have to be concerned about. But once again, tremendous teamwork. I have a flag from the City of Falls Church that we know. I'm going to unfold this. I don't know if we get it folded back or not, but and the next one will be easier because it's a proclamation, and I will not read it because we've done that before, but it just let me say that in the end we say, now therefore we proclaim this is Mary Ellen Henderson Day in the City of Falls Church. And as recognition of her devotion to students, education, human rights, and overall Falls Church spirit. And it's really a pleasure to see the Henderson family here in force today. It's an honor to be here to celebrate this with you. So from the city, Dr. Friedman.
Thank you, Mayor. Delegate Jim Scott and Senator Mary Margaret Whipple are also here today to bring greetings from the General Assembly.
Thank you very much, Chairman Chandler and Dr. Friedman and Dr. Berlin, Dr. DeMary. Mayor Gardner, it's always a pleasure for Mary Margaret and me to join in celebrating something happening in Falls Church. One of the little known facts of the history of this community is that I actually was a teacher for 6 weeks, shop substitute teacher at George Mason High School. So, I have a very strong commitment to this community and to your schools. It's a delight for me to be here today to present to you a commendation, an official commendation from the House of Delegates for this wonderful event. I'd like to ask the mayor as well as the superintendent to join us, please, on the platform, along with Kathy Chandler. And Mary Margaret has also something she wants to present.
I add my best wishes on this most auspicious occasion. It's a wonderful day for Falls Church, for this community, for the school system, and most especially for the students. And so I, too, am very happy to be here and have brought a commendation from the Senate of Virginia. And then Jim and I together, Jim and I together have a Virginia flag for you that was flown over the Capitol in Richmond, and are happy to present this to the school. There we are.
Thank you, Delegate Scott and Senator Whipple. U.S. Representative Jim Moran brings greetings from Congress.
Well, thank you, and congratulations, Principal. I know you're going to enjoy this beautiful new school with, it's just something so exciting when you walk into the school. I enjoyed the tour we took as they were constructing it. And it's nice to see Mrs. Henderson's family. We had a nice visit earlier in the week, her son and her grandson and her granddaughter-in-law, Nikki, is that Nikki Grayson. I'm trying to get the family straight. I put a statement in the Congressional Record so that we would be recognizing Mrs. Henderson at the national level, similarly to the way we have at the local and the state level. We also have an American flag, and having watched how the mayor unfurled the City of Falls Church flag, I think I'm just going to keep this boxed, and when you choose, Rochelle, to sort of unfurl it and put it up on the flagpole, you may choose to do that. Not that it wasn't very smoothly done, Dan, but it's... let me just make say a few words, though. At a time when this whole nation has been exposed to the face of poverty and the results of historic and institutionalized racism in the Gulf Coast, it's important for us to understand how history evolves, how progress and change is achieved. The City of Falls Church is a wonderful community, progressive, enlightened. It's a great place to live. It's inclusive and it's tolerant. But you have to ask yourself what Falls Church would be like if a person like Dr. Edwin Henderson and Mary Ellen Henderson had not chosen to live in Falls Church. Why do these things happen? Mary Ellen Henderson was teaching in the District of Columbia. She married Ed Henderson, so she moves to Falls Church. And Falls Church was never the same since. When she decided to teach, walking every day, lugging buckets of water because there was no running water in that little two-room schoolhouse, disciplining the children, and you must have had to when you think fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh grades. I mean, imagine. But everybody did what they were told, what teacher Nellie, Miss Nellie, told them to do. What one wonders what would have happened if, when the City of Falls Church at that time, in the early part of the 20th century, decided to have an exclusive community for what they in that time called colored people. In other words, walling them off from the rest of the community. And Dr. Henderson and Mrs. Henderson stood up defiantly and led the effort not to let that happen, formed the Colored Citizens Protective League, which then became the first rural branch of the NAACP in the country. One wonders what our community in Northern Virginia might have been. One wonders if Mrs. Henderson, with all that she had to do raising her children and as a wife and as a teacher, she would have had so many excuses. But she decided to make the special effort to document the disparities between white and black education in Falls Church, to document it, to prove it, and then to challenge the authorities to change it. I could go down a list of the kinds of things that Mr. and Mrs. Henderson did to change their world, what is now our world, partly because they were leaders of their world. And I trust, and because I know some of the character of your superintendent and I've heard of your principal and a few of the teachers, I have a suspicion that every child that comes through Mary Ellen Henderson School is going to learn about who this person was, whether they be Anglo-American or African-American or Latino-American or Asian-American, every child, because they need to know about real heroism, real courage, real leadership. And, you know, that's the way we mortals sort of pass on a certain immortality to people who really deserve it. Mrs. Henderson deserves that kind of, at least temporary, if you can say that, immortality legacy that will go on for generations as we name this school. It raises the question, who was Mary Ellen Henderson? She was a person who changed the face of Falls Church, and that's really what this celebration is all about. So thanks all of you for being here for it.
Thank you, Mr. Moran, and I understand you may have to get up and leave us, but thank you so much for being here with us today. Of course, no celebration is complete without music, and that's where members of the Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School Band come in. You may have heard these talented musicians play a few selections before the program started. And they're ready to entertain us again, so under the direction of Connie Jenkins.
Thank you.
Thank you, students. Thank you, Ms. Jenkins. It wasn't so long ago that our next guest walked the halls of George Mason High School as a student. Today, our class of 1981 graduate, Jamie Martin, has returned both as the developer of this project and as the parent of the next generation of Martins who will attend our schools. And he has a few dedication day surprises to share with us.
Thank you, Mrs. Chandler. It's great to be here today. Thanks, everybody, for coming out. In the 24 years since graduating from George Mason, just a short time, I've had a great amount of opportunity to work on many prestigious jobs around Washington, but I've never had the satisfaction of working on a project like I have here. This has been a great project. The success of this project, and it's been delivered on time and under budget, one of our milestones. That success is attributable to the team we've had involved, and I know they've been mentioned before, but it doesn't hurt to mention them again. We've had a lot of different players involved. Certainly all of the community has been involved, but as our team came together, we had a great group of people that I want to just mention real quickly. Then I have a few special announcements. We got involved with this project initially through the work of two members of our team, Claudia Muir and Jeff Stryker. I think they're here with us today. They worked on the concepts originally to help bring this project together, and they get a lot of credit for the thought process of finding a spot to put a school in Falls Church when there was no land to be had. Our other team members, Barry Rio, Urban Engineering, Strickler Associates, Ellett Bryan, we had a large group of design professionals that worked very hard to come up with the concept, the building that you see now that was built within our budget, and which I think is going to succeed greatly in educating our children. All of that design work culminated in the actual construction, and the Clark team, we saw them earlier, but these guys worked tirelessly to get this project done and took great care to see that it was done right. So, and lastly, again, mentioned before, but the City Council and the School Board, through our process of getting to this point, has been great, and working with them was a pleasure, especially the superintendents, Mary Ellen and Lois Berlin. Great people, and we've had a great time working with them, part of that personal satisfaction that came with the job. And then, as mentioned before, Construction Dynamics Group, the consultant for the city, has been the most professional group I've worked with, and helped us get this project along, helped us with the bumps in the roads that come with a project like this, and we were very successful at navigating those bumps in a smooth fashion, if you will. For the special announcements, I have two of those. One, most people know about, but I wanted to make note of it. As you came in today, you might have noticed that we have a display of time capsule items. We've created a spot in the building to create a time capsule, and we've asked the children at the school to help come up with some ideas of what's going to go in the time capsule. Those items include the Harry Potter and the Chronicles of Narnia books, current periodicals, some newspapers, and a good sampling of SpongeBob SquarePants memorabilia. Now, this time capsule is scheduled to be open in 50 years, and I'm really curious about what people are going to say about those SpongeBob items. We've got letters that are going to be contributed to the time capsule. Some sixth graders contributed. Those were Shahir Ahmed, Chasby Hagner, Ashia, and Ahmad Zaval. We had seventh graders Alex Armstrong and Hannah Walker, and an eighth grader, Autumn Brennan. Now, as you go out and as you tour the school, I'd like you to take a look at the time capsule items, because as I said, they're going to be put away for 50 years. We have a spot at the front of the school that'll contain the time capsule, and it'll be a marker made of stone that has the year 2005 written into it. And on that note, I'd like to say I hope to see everybody there when we get to open that. My last announcement has to do with a gift that Clark Construction is going to make to the school. As a tribute to the school's namesake, Mary Ellen Henderson, we have commissioned a painting of a portrait of Mary Ellen Henderson that can be hung in the school. What makes this special is that we've engaged the services of a world-renowned portrait artist. His name is Mr. Simi Knox. Mr. Knox, once known as the artist of judges for his portraits of Supreme Court justices, has more recently become the artist of a president and a first lady. Mr. Knox painted the official White House portrait of President Clinton and First Lady and now Senator Hillary Rodham Clinton. Mr. Knox, who has been painting portraits for over 25 years, has painted many famous celebrities and officials, including the late Justice Thurgood Marshall, Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, Alex Haley, Bill Cosby, and Hank Aaron, just to name a few. But what's more appropriately suited about Mr. Knox is that he spent 18 years as a public school art teacher, and that relationship really draws him to the school. I think it will be a very nice memorial to Mary Ellen Henderson to have her portrait painted by such a well-known portrait artist. And I'm excited to tell you that Mr. Knox has joined us today, and I'd just like you to introduce you to him. He's going to meet a lot of people, and in the coming months, he's going to finish this portrait. We'll have a dedication ceremony again when that's done. Mr. Knox. Thank you all very much. This has been a great project. When you're in another school, give me a call. I'll be happy to help out.
Thank you, Mr. Martin and Mr. Knox, and thank Clark for your generous donation. As you know, our students participate in a wide variety of artistic endeavors, and Mr. Knox, you're a wonderful role model for them. We will look forward to unveiling your magnificent painting next year during Women's History Month. In the meantime, I hope everyone will take time to view the new Henderson collection of student artwork on display here at the middle school. The collection is a result of a partnership between Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School and Art and Frame of Falls Church. Each year, student works from each middle school class will be selected and added to the collection and be permanently displayed here at the school. This is such a special day for all of us, but perhaps no more so than for the Henderson family. Ladies and gentlemen, here now to share some personal remembrances is Mary Ellen Henderson's son, Dr. James H.M. Henderson, who is accompanied by his son, Mr. Edward Henderson, and Ms. Nikki Graves.
Members of the board here, other members, ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure for me to be here this evening, but I must make two comments first. And it's not in retrospect, but it's current. And that is, standing next to me are Nikki and Ed, without whom you would not be here today. So let's give them a real round of applause. And also, if I may call her this, Kathy, I have to thank you too. You know why. Thank you. Anyway, a few remarks I'd like to say. Are there some members of the my mother's class here? If they are any of the students of Mary Ellen Henderson here, please stand and let us recognize you. I'm sure they are. That's right, there they are. Well, many of the remarks I could make have already been said by me and shown in the video you just saw. There are one or two I'd like to remember, though. And one of these has to do with, you heard the talk about, I said something about carrying that little black bag. It was 2 miles, I should mention that. That little black bag which she had to put together every morning as she went to school and carry that bag down to the school. With all the things in it that she had, including food, luncheon, and other things like that. I will have to say this. I remember the school, although actually my brother and I never enrolled in the school. We went there to be babysat. And I always remember several things. That stove in the middle, of course we remember that. But also I remember, as some of you might that in the back of the room, as you came in that door, the first, second, and third grades were on the left door, and my mother's room was on the right door. You had to walk up some steps. And right in the corner there, you remember, there was that water cooler. You had to bring your own cups. That's where you got your clean water to drink. Ms. Mirtha Lee, next door, supplied the water, didn't she? That's right. I'm not going to talk, as I said to you, about what was out back. I won't want to describe that at all. And actually have to go out, they had to go, once they finally got to get coal, you remember, some of the boys had to go out, get the coal, bring it in, put it in that stove. I always remember that the room was divided into four sections. There was a section here, a section here, a section up front, section there, and a stove in the middle with a blackboard on the front. You ladies will remember better than I. As I say, I was not more than, at the most, 4 or 5 years old when I finally went to school in Washington, where my father would go every day. But I can remember the number of times that my mother would be going there, and rain or shine, she was there. And whether it was without with an umbrella or whatever, she would go. I always remember she used to say that the children who came there were such wonderful children. I don't think that was quite said on the video that you heard part of, but they were so wonderful. Come rain or shine, they were there every day, from wherever they came, more miles than my mother came from, actually. Also, I would say that around my mother, although we lived on what was called a farm, it was somewhat of a farm. We had a bigger farm up about a mile and a half away, where my father, after school, coming in from school at night, would go with us, would light the horse and the plow and plow the cornfield. But at home, my mother, since my father had to go to school in Washington every day, she did most of the work there. A farmer she was. I can see a picture now of myself when I was, it had to be when I was about, I guess, less than a year old, with my brother standing there with my mother with a long shirt on, and there were the chickens, the cows, and all standing around us. I use that picture to say, don't you think I was born on a farm? Well, they got to look at the picture and they can see that. But my mother was such a fine lady. I do remember one incident. Spare the child, spare the rod, and spoil the child. Once, I remember when I was in junior high school, cut class, or it was took off one day. The word got back to my mother. You know what we did? We went up to what was a reservoir around Howard University and went fishing with pins and a string and fished through the bars. That word got home to my mother. That's the only time I remember that I had to stand up on a couch there, and that whip, she got that little strap, that little stitch, and I got the whipping that time. Anyway, those are some of the common incidents I remember. Also, I remember that on one occasion, I forget the lady's name, who was there when my mother, when I wasn't old enough to go to school with her. I forget her name now. My memory's not that good. But I remember that when my mother came home one day, she found out that I had gotten adventurous, because in the stove, in the room where I was staying, there was a little stove in the corner. I'd gotten a little stick and pushed it through the little entrance there for the draft, and it was a closet right there behind it. I decided to venture in to see what was in the closet. And there, it wasn't for this case, I wouldn't be here talking today. I went to that closet with that little stick and caught on to some cotton or something back there. And fortunately, the lady whose name I can't remember came back and got that out. My mother got home. I might have gotten a spanking, I know, but anyway, that was one of those times when I knew that she really meant she was serious about that. So it's been a wonderful life, I must say, with my mother and my father. My mother, as I say, who had to be, and my wife will always tell me about what men do and what women do. My father, of course, was away most of the day in Washington, where he was administrating the school. So my mother had to do much of the work. I milked cows, too, and my mother had to take care of them, the chickens and the horses and the cows, and those sorts of things. So she was a farmer as well as a teacher. And so I want to say how tremendous lady and mother and wife she was. and I always remember how great they were in teaching us the things to do in the right manner. And today I hope whatever I've achieved, I can say that my mother and father, but since I was with my mother most of the time, I have to give most of the credit to my mother for whatever I've done in the world, I have to give her the credit too. Thank you very much. Got one statement, and that is, my dear wife there, Gwen, will you stand up, please, is always saying, the Henderson men always get all the credit. But at least on this occasion, we're so happy that the Henderson woman and others, here they are. They've gotten the great credit. Not that the men haven't done a good job, too, but Mary Ellen Henderson, this is absolutely wonderful. I can't tell you how happy I am for this occasion. Thank you so much.
Thank
May I give you a kiss?
You sure can.
Thank you very much. You know why I'm thanking you.
Yeah.
Number four. Right.
Thank you, Dr. Henderson. Of course, every school needs a school song, and our student singers have been warming up their vocal cords to share their new song with you. Will the Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School Chorus please come forward? And while they're taking the stage, I want to point out that the words to the song are in your program on the inside of the cover, so please sing along. School students Tyrone Thompson, Brittany Thompson, Blake Halder, and Christopher Horniman for greeting our guests and serving as our student ambassadors today. I also want to thank our ASAP students and staff for creating the beautiful banner that you saw as you entered the cafetorium. And I also want to thank our maintenance supervisor, Mr. Terry Dingus, and our custodial staff for working overtime not only in preparation for this big day, but in preparation for the first day of school. So thanks to all of them. This day has been such a thrill for all of us. It marks the end of the construction phase of this building and the beginning of the great new opportunities in public education for our students. The process of building this school has been tedious and the sacrifices have been many. But as Benjamin Franklin once said, an investment in knowledge pays the best interest. We hope you all will take time to tour the building today, to enjoy the photographic displays throughout the building, and to join us in a reception following the program right now. The main item on the menu is cake, birthday cake, of course, because today would have been Mary Ellen Henderson's 120th birthday. Students, how about leading us in the birthday song?
Happy birthday, dear Henderson. Happy birthday.
everybody for coming. Now enjoy yourselves at the reception. There are many tables with food around the room. If you would just please keep the food in this building, in this room, we'd appreciate it. But enjoy the building. Thank you.